women in the field. And this segment deals with correctional, female correctional employees and issues that there are on work and cautions and some of the best practices that we've learned of women working within the field. And this is about equity and social justice. You've all heard about the glass ceiling, and the question is, can women penetrate or have women penetrated that glass ceiling? And we hope by this presentation you'll find out. Most of the women on the panelists agree things are getting much better, and they're certainly a lot better than they were in the 60s and 70s. So with that said, we'll go ahead and get started. And I will go ahead and introduce our panel members. We'll start with Rebecca on the end. You can introduce yourself and tell them a little something about you.
Sure, so my name is Becca Judy. I'm the Director of State Reentry Operations and PREA Coordinator for Pioneer Human Services based out of Seattle, but statewide in Washington. I'm gonna talk about PREA a little bit later. It's the Prison Rape Elimination Act, and so I'm looking forward to it.
And my name is Wanda McRae, and I work with the Department of Corrections. I've worked in corrections for about 40 years now, and the bulk of my time has been working with women offenders. And currently I'm working with community corrections in the Renton Field office.
Greetings, my name is Stephanie Guy. I'm an instructor for South Seattle Community College. I work for the enforcement department, working with men and women in transition from prison to jail.
My name is Amy Kiilsholm, and I also work at South Seattle Community College, teaching in the same department, life skills to work.
Okay, thank you. We'll go ahead and get started now. And I'm Runette Mitchell. I'm with the King County Department of Adult and Juvenile Detention, Community Corrections. I've been with the county about a little more than 38 years. And I started as a corrections officer, became a sergeant, and I've been in my current position. And I'm gonna give you an overview of women in the workforce. And this slide here shows you that the majority of the population in the United States is female, 51% or close to 52% to 48% of men. The labor force between men and women is 46.8%, which is a little shy, and we maybe talk later about why the workforce is a little different than women in the population. This will also talk about the earnings of women and unemployment rates by gender. You see that the rate for women is 6.1% and men is 6.3%. Okay, this is the national labor force by gender. You'll look around and see the Asian American, these are comparisons of males and females, their statistics within the workplace, and you can see in all the areas men are leading and women are behind. And this is by gender and race. And you'll see that Asian and African American, Hispanic, and white race. This is by education. One of the things that is really indicative of your success and how far you can go is your skills and your education. You look on these charts, you can see the differences in salary made by those with less than a high school diploma compared to those with a bachelor's degree and an advanced degree. So a woman's earning power is really heightened by educational pursuits. And these are the 25 highest paying occupations for women, and all these statistics come from the U.S. Department of Labor. And one at the very bottom is for probation officers and correctional treatment. And you'll see that that's the one area where the women really lead the men. So our field is really opening up more so for women. Okay, this is employment of correctional officers by jailers and state employees. You'll look around, it's state, county, and city employees. And really the best numbers you see are here on the West Coast, where the rates are really a lot higher than other places. And this is really a good place to work. And you can look at the panel on the right, and it gives the employment number of people that were employed. And this was as of May of 2014. And here's the annual mean wage of correctional officers and jailers, again by state, and the whole West Coast from Alaska to Hawaii are the highest rates that are here, where people are earning about from $50,000 to $71,000 a year. Okay, we have come a long way in 50 years. In 1962, you can compare the rates with 2012 of participation in the workforce. And as it said at the bottom, Black and African American women earnings increased by 75% from 1967 to the current, compared to all other races, which increased by 55%, and even that is not bad. Here's, again, it's the National Women's Median Weekly Earnings by Education and Race. Again, you'll look at less than a high school diploma, you see the lower rates, and as education progresses, so does pay. And so one of the things that you can do is encourage yourself, your daughters, your sisters to go to school and complete an advanced degree, because it really makes a significant difference in your ability to earn a wage. And this slide shows contributors to the change for the status of women in the labor force. You look at from 1938 with the essence of the Fair Labor Standards Act all the way down to 2010, different legislation or things that happened to increase women in the workplace. Moms in the workplace, with this particular cause, there's a little shame sometimes society puts on working moms, because why aren't you home taking care of your children? Also, there's sometimes a little guilt because you feel that, well, I should be with my children, but due to economic situations, many families have to become both spouses that are employed. And you'll see the number or the ages of the children and how that reflects within the different racial and ethnic groups. And this is, again, at the bottom with the woman. She's juggling everything to get everything done, and a lot of you I know do the same. Here's some amazing facts about women in the workplace, that 34% of Black or African American women are the sole breadwinners for their families, versus 18% for other races. I didn't know that until I did this research and found out, wow, that's a really quite a thing. And women accounted for 50% of all workers in the high-paying management professionals and related occupations. Asian American women as a group have the highest earnings over all other races. However, they also have the largest earning gap compared to their men. Somehow this. Okay, how successful women cope with their jobs and strategies. And this is the advice that they give. They say, one, do your job. Two, interact with coworkers in a straightforward, non-manipulative manner, and do so consistently. Develop a reputation for treating others fairly and impartially. Develop a support network of other women in the organization. Dress appropriately. Be prepared for initial negative reactions. Deal with conflict decisively and assertively. Build positive relationships with male co-workers. Keep an open mind and be supportive of other women. And it, again, you can read through this a lot. It's counsel from leading women and colleagues in our industry. And this comes from a Correctional Women's Professional Association. And it's a lot of skills. We have that sign-in if you'd like to get a copy. We have three PowerPoints that we're sharing today. If you'd like to get a copy, you can sign in and we'll email them to you. Here are value-added strengths for women. Women, this is what we bring to the workplace, a demonstration that it is the skill and the individual's contribution, not their gender, which makes for successful and valuable corrections professionals. Successful women leaders don't rely on favors. They earn respect and truly believe they can influence their own causes and advancement by serving others. And you'll look at those people that had awards today, it was all about service. That we're all here to earn a living, but we're also here to provide service. And the women invest in themselves and become knowledge seekers. Seek out opportunities to learn, to grow, and to develop, and that's really a way to get ahead. And those women are master multitaskers and highly collaborative, though not afraid to get territorial to protect their domain. And those are our references. And here's our panel information.
Can you leave the panel information up?
I'll come back to it at the end. And if you sign the list, I'll email it to you.
Perfect. Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. As I mentioned, and for those of you who come in, my name is Becca Judy. Do I need to stand up? Okay, good afternoon, everyone. Becca Judy, and I'm with Pioneer Human Services. I am the Director of State Reentry Operations and the PREA Coordinator. And today I'm going to be talking about PREA just a little bit and the implications for women who are in the field of corrections and reentry. So a little bit about myself, how I got here. I have been in the nonprofit industry for well over a decade. Started in the human services sector about 13 years ago, and ended up at Pioneer Human Services. I started as the assistant director of two work release facilities, so people transitioning out of prison, still incarcerated, but finding employment, housing, and reuniting with families. And I became the director in 2011, and then just started my new position, overseeing all of the DOC contracted facilities across the state. February. And then I'm also the PREA coordinator. So PREA, for those of you who are not familiar, is the Prison Rape Elimination Act of 2003. It was passed unanimously in 2003 by Congress, and it was designed to provide information, resources, recommendations, and funding to protect individuals from prison rape. So it's all about sexual safety. And you can see here it covers sexual harassment, both staff on resident is what we call them, or offender. And then resident on resident, as well as sexual assault, sexual abuse, and staff sexual misconduct. So the idea behind PREA is that when it's a staff and a resident or staff and an offender, there is no such thing as consensual sex because of the power differential. So in 2009, there were proposed standards for an audit that came out, and then finally in August of 2012, the Department of Justice went through their final review and approved the standards for an audit process. So as part of my role as the PREA coordinator with Pioneer is ensuring that organization-wide, whether at a corporate level or at the program level, that we are PREA compliant, which is a long, dark rabbit hole. But it's very interesting and obviously worth the work. So a few things about how this impacts, and this is very high level, there are much, much more granular impacts as far as women, both the residents and staff. But some of the key ones in terms of how this impacts women, and we're going to show a video for the first two after the PowerPoint, but and I'm going to kind of get my statistics here real quick. So according to the Department of Justice and the Bureau of Justice Statistics, women staff members are much, much more likely to commit staff sexual misconduct than their male counterparts. And as I mentioned, due to the power differential, there is no such thing as consent.
And so according to the Bureau of Justice Statistics, the percent of, okay, so the sex of perpetrator of staff sexual misconduct for when the male was the victim, 72% of the time it was a female, and the male's likelihood of falling victim to staff sexual misconduct is about 17 times as likely as the female victim. Does that make sense? So much, much more likely to be a male who is victimized, and almost always that is a female that's committing it. And I just think it's important to know that, you know, nobody walks into work one day and says, I'm gonna commit staff sexual misconduct today. You know, it's something that happens over time. It happens through a very set system of manipulation, playing on somebody's emotions, isolating them in certain ways. And so, you know, I feel like somebody that's coming into this field needs to be very aware of that. They need to be very deliberate about the boundaries that they set. And that's not to say that you go in, you know, not trusting anybody and anything, you know, anybody says, but you have to be aware of the fact that this exists. And then finally, one last note. There are four states, and that's Alaska, Utah, Idaho, and Arkansas, who are saying we are not going to be PREA compliant to the Department of Justice. And the biggest reason that is because of there's a standard that limits cross-gender pat searches. And because of the prevalence, especially in some of these more remote neighborhoods, areas like Arkansas and Alaska, the prevalence of women in the field, they're saying that limits and it causes a financial hardship in order for them to be able to do that. So that video, any questions about PREA? Who was familiar with PREA before today? Okay, most people.
I think a lot of people who look at Joyce Mitchell wonder how somebody can get to a place where she helped somebody escape from prison. I wonder how it happened for you. What was it that this guy did or said that created that
connection? Well, first of all, I think a woman has to be at a point where she's pretty broken and she's in a desperate state. And when you're in that state, things that normally seem ridiculous don't seem so far-fetched. So in my instance, I was working really hard. I had a lifetime where I worked really hard and I performed at a high level. And I just felt this tremendous pressure to always be on and be my best for everybody and everything that I did. And I reached a breaking point. And in my case, I happened to reach the breaking point just at the same time that an inmate took notice of me and told me how nice I looked and acted like he cared about what kind of a mood I was in on that particular day. And
was he somebody who kind of you felt listened to you or noticed things about you when other people in your life didn't?
Yes, exactly. And we would spend a lot of time talking and it was just, you know, human beings want to have a connection with somebody, and when you have someone who just spends a lot of time talking to you and telling you things about you that you like to hear, it's kind of just like pouring water on a dying plant.
I know he sort of became your protector. There was an incident where somebody threatened you and he stepped in. He became your escort around the prison. I've talked to some experts who say that often it starts with something small, like a small, will you do me a favor? It's kind of a baby step, and you kind of end up on this journey that you never thought you would end up being on.
Yes, exactly. And I think, you know, anything in our life, I think, starts with baby steps, just like that. But in my case, it was, you know, someone stuck up for me and kept me from being physically accosted by an inmate. I felt in fear at that time. So it did kind of change the flavor of everything. But I do believe that if I had been at a point where I was strong and courageous and not so broken, not so desperate as I was, that it wouldn't have mattered. It wouldn't have happened.
I know you took money out, I think, of out of your bank account or a savings policy that you had. You bought a vehicle, an escape vehicle. Did it seem real even the day you were driving to the prison to help him break out? I mean, did it seem like something, this was really going to happen?
No, it never seemed like it was going to happen. I still sometimes can't believe it did happen. The whole time, you know, we were talking about it, it was kind of like a game, like, well, what if this happened, and what if this happened? And I never really believed it until, even the minute I was driving through the gate, I didn't think it was happening. But once I got outside the gate and he was in the van, then it was real. And I was just stunned. I can't look back and see the path I took that got me to that point. It just seemed like I was just there.
As I stated earlier, I've been working with corrections in about 40 years, and my experience with corrections is that I have a degree in education, and my thought was that I'm just going to do this for a little while, and then I'm going to get a real job. 40 years later, I'm still in corrections. And so when I started some 40 years ago, the men worked in the men facilities and the women worked women facilities. If there were women in the male facilities, they had limited jobs they could do. For instance, they worked at the gates. They worked in areas that were non-residential. They worked in the visiting room, or they did administrative posts. And because of that, that meant that their promotions opportunities were very limited. Concerns that were prevalent during that time was the supervision, the cross-gender supervision. There were opportunities or laws, in fact, that said that a person of an opposite gender could not observe another person, you know, with their clothes off. And in most of the cells, they didn't have rooms in the male facility. They had cells, and they were open front. And they also had the urinal or the commode was there, and so the women, that's why most of the women officers were not allowed on the tier, because the law prevented them from looking or seeing a male with their clothes off. And so the restrictions were there as far as the residential, as far as the transport. You know, when we are, especially with women, we're transporting women, then you need female officers to do most of the transport, or at least one, if there's two, at least one should be a female. We're doing home visits in the community. We require our community corrections officers, is what we call them. We require them to, if they have a cross-gender transport, we require them to call us. They call us when they leave, and they give us the mileage in the car, and they call us when they get there and in the time, so that we can chronologically log the time they left, time they got there, and the time they got back because of the transport. That can make some difficulty or concerns with the department when it comes to cross-gender supervision. When we talk about community corrections, we're talking about probation, parole, community supervision, and then the ongoing concerns with working in community corrections. We also have the work release, electronic home monitoring, community work crews, halfway houses, treatment, housing, and day reporting. And when you're looking at work crews especially, do we have female officers supervising work crews out in a community setting? Those are the concerns that the department has as a whole. When we're looking at community corrections, again, we talked about the transport, or if we're taking someone to the jail, and I usually require that at least two officers. And when you have a day when there is a shortage of officers available, sometimes having two officers to do a transport is really difficult, but it's necessary, mainly because of the protection of the transporting officer. When community corrections programs include home visits, I try to require at least two officers to go out into the home when they're visiting. Again, it's not always possible, it's not always probable, but I think it is sometimes necessary, especially if you go into a home as a female and there's a male when you're going to visit a male offender. And then some programs only allow the women to do that with a male escort. Safety concerns, of course, is paramount. So what happened to kind of make this shift in having women in prisons, women in male prisons? When I first started working with the Department of Corrections, even at the Women's Corrections Center where I started, the ratio of staff was 50% male, 50% women. That was the only prison in the state that was half, 50%. The others, you maybe had 20% women working in some of the male facilities. And of course, there was always some of the women, they were given a hard time when they elected to chose to work in a male facility, because the climate there was kind of anti-female. They didn't like having women there, and so they did things to kind of get them to move out or leave from working in that facility. And because of litigation, there was lots of litigation that came about, and because of the litigation, then you saw the shift and the change in allowing women to work in male facilities and to work in all positions, not just working in the visit room or not just working at the entry gate with people coming and letting people in and out, things like that. Letting them work where they had interactions with the male offenders and also opportunities for more responsibilities and opportunities to promote within the facilities and within the department. And it's shown too as well when I worked in the male facilities. I worked at McNeil Island for about 3 to 4 years. And what I saw was that actually a female officer had better control of the male offenders. And in what world, in our world today, in fact, you have, you need both genders. You don't just need an environment where there's only men or only women working. You need to have that balance. And I also noticed that when I was working at the Correction Center for Women, that we also need the men. The men had an influence over the women as well. A lot of them looked at them as father figures, except that was absent when they were growing up. So whenever a woman would go in, if the men were all acting all out of sorts, a woman would go in, they immediately would calm down. So it's good having women in the male facilities. And because of their experience, their nurturing and the bonding, the things that we bring to a workplace, it makes it different. It makes it a lot better for the men, for the offenders themselves, as well as the staff. So we look at their dedication to the profession, their skills, and their job performance. All of these things added to making working at Walla Walla, working at Monroe, or working at Shelton, the reception center, a better experience for everyone. And in the same hand, it also increased our opportunities to promote within the system, increase in pay as well. So now what we have today, we have women working in uniform and non-uniform positions in all facilities. We still have a higher percentage of females working in the women's prison. And again, that was dictated because of the PREA, which we talked about earlier, the PREA laws, because there's so many operations and things that we have to do that require women. So we have more women working in the two female facilities that we have within the Department of Corrections. We can hold positions in secure areas. We can work in the intensive management units where you have some of the most violent, volatile offenders, but women can work in these areas. And they have direct contact with the male offenders. One of the things that I've noticed, and in fact, when I first started working with the Department of Corrections in Washington State, we had one female superintendent. And she was the superintendent at the female facility. And in 1987, I think we got a second female superintendent, and that was at the Twin Rivers Correction Center up at the Monroe Complex. And I was thinking at the time, I said, we got two. I was better be kind of, I was kind of scared for her. And you know what, 1988, she got replaced, and so we went back down to one female. But in the 90s, we started seeing more female superintendents coming online. And in fact, at one time, we had, of the 14 prisons, we had 7 women and 7 men. So you can see how that shift came around the 90s and early 2000s, where you had more female superintendents. And I did have, I think, a slide. We already talked about the workforce, and she gave us the stats about how women do outnumber men. In fact, I think there was like 52% more women in the United States than men. So we ought to be running. That's true. And what I want to see in 2016 is our first female president. That's what I'm hoping for. That's what I'm shooting for. But I did want to share the stats. I thought I had put that slide in there. Yes, I did. Where we are today, demographic-wise, for the department, we have 8,235 employees with the Department of Corrections, and of those 8,000 employees, 3,000 are women. So we make up about 37% of the Department of Corrections. But as far as appointing authorities, we have appointing authorities are our executive leaders, or our extended executives. We have 50, and 25 of them are women. So we're running about 50% of executive leadership within the Department of Corrections. As I stated earlier, I had said I was only going to do this for a year, and then I was going to get a real job. So 40 years later, I'm still here. I'm here because I see the need. I like working with people, and I think that corrections is a viable career opportunity for women. And it's one that, if you're not already in it, that you should look at joining up with us. Thank you.
Do you have the breakdown that would include racial demographics?
I do.
As well?
Yeah, do you want to hear
it?
Yes, please. Sure. We have, out of the 8,000 employees, we have 445 African Americans, 139 Native Americans, 333 Pacific Islanders or Asians, and 545 Hispanics, for a total of 1,471 or 18% persons of color.
Can we ask questions?
Well, we were trying to save them until last. Can it wait?
I guess. Okay. That's not on the rules.
Okay, no, go ahead.
Right now?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm a formerly incarcerated woman, and I was subjected to a bunch of mandated treatment programs that were tested on men, and they were one size fits all. And I'm just wondering, with women, with so many women now in the Department of Corrections, what are you doing to ensure that there's gender appropriate treatment being given to the population?
One of the things that we've done, in fact, we started in 2012, we started our gender responsive programming, and the department passed an initiative where we will look at gender responsive programming for the women. And it started, we started some of the programming at the Correction Center for Women, and we've also extended it to Mission Creek Correction Center for Women. We have, we're looking at Moving On, which is the one of the programs that was started, we got it from the National Institute of Corrections, which is helping the women to deal with their trauma. Because most of the women, if you talk with them, they have experienced severe trauma. And so we've also started to educate our staff on being trauma-informed so that they can recognize when a woman is acting out, not because of the sake of acting out, but there's something behind her driving her to act in this way. We also have educated our staff on motivational interviewing, and the motivational interviewing is an opportunity for the staff. All staff has to go through motivational interviewing, and it gives them an opportunity to recognize when an offender is acting out emotionally, and to just acknowledge it. And it works. You know, I was so surprised the first time I used it, and this offender was just going and go, "I see that you're angry," and she went, you know, like she was just so happy that somebody finally recognized that she was angry. And so the next step is, so what do you want us to do? What can we do? And so that's, it's a lot of times we had that separation between custody and offenders. It had this line, "I can only count you, give you your supplies." And so now we're getting them more, especially in the women's side of the house, more involved with talking to the offenders and being there for them to help them move on.
Wanda, I'm Karen Harold Prayer. I'm the Veteran Service Manager. How are you?
Good.
Hey, a question I have for you is the women that are coming in to Purdy and Mission Creek who are veterans. I know that some of them have suffered sexual trauma through the military. And I guess my question for you is the staff at Purdy or Mission Creek, are they up to speed on combat trauma, sexual trauma within the military? Are they getting that education? Because it is very specific for women. And I guess that's my question for you.
Not specifically for veterans. Again, we do have mental health staff on site that once they have disclosed this to us, we can get them referred to that. But as far as the day-to-day officer on the job, no.
Maybe I should come out and do a presentation for you guys.
That'd be great.
Here you go. Okay, thanks.
Okay. How many people here are parents? How many people here have children under the age of 18? Okay, all right. So I'm giving you company in that I'm sleep deprived, yes. So I'm gonna talk to you just a little bit today about keeping balance, finding balance, and keeping balance. It seems like as women and as moms, we do, like you picture, a lot of juggling right of that process. How many people in here have found a skill or an outlet that helps them keep really good balance? What you got?
I own a horse, so I do a lot of work at the barn.
Nice, nice. And what is it about being at the barn that helps you?
Well, when you're riding, you really can't think about what's going on around you. You have to be really present, so it's a way to forget about everything that's going on outside of the barn and just let me enjoy myself for a minute or just let go of what happened that day.
Right on. Yeah. Somebody else? Yes.
I just read. Sometimes take a few minutes out just to read and check myself out.
Yeah.
What I'm trying to do. So.
Right. Let's the brain calm down. Excellent.
Yeah.
So you guys get Kind Awards. Have you guys had these Kind bars? They're super healthy and they're yummy and only 5 grams of sugar. Yes. So you get Kind Awards for being kind to yourself. Because it's hard work and it's important, isn't it? I recently had the opportunity to go see a documentary that was filmed right here in Seattle called Having It All. Anybody familiar with this documentary? So it was with Parent Map, and Dr. John Gottman spoke at that at a seminar afterwards. Is anybody here familiar with Dr. Gottman's work on relationships? Isn't he amazing? Yeah. So this is the short version of Having It All. They followed 3 women through Seattle who were career women, who were educated and wanted to start families. 2 of the 3 ended up divorced. And that is about what the research shows happens to relationships after kids come along. Marital satisfaction decreases in about 70% of relationships, which leaves women, oftentimes as single parents, juggling even more. So his research is well worth looking into if you want to learn about relationships, and he has what he calls the masters and disasters of relationships, of what makes them succeed and what makes them fail, and what people who are naturally good at them, what they do. Aside from that, I'm going to touch just briefly. This book, Emotional Survival for Law Enforcement, I went to a training and got to learn about this guy, and he's absolutely fascinating. And there's a quote in here that I think is very valid to all of us. It's a little bit rude, but I think you'll appreciate the spirit. Nobody escapes with their professional virginity intact. Everyone gets screwed at least one time. And so the point, and the point that this author makes a lot is invest in your home life, which is why I was just talking about relationships. At the end of the day, at the end of our season, on Earth, very few people say, I wish I spent another day at the office. Now, there's other reasons, too, why it's important to invest in your home life. One of them that this author talks about is, he explains survivors versus victims, and these are the emotional survivors. This is what they do. They have very aggressive personal time management. You control what you can. At work, we've all got somebody we report to, and they sort of control parts of our day and our decision making. At home, when we exercise control over our personal time management, it gives us a sense of empowerment. It's also important to make those plans early in the day, early in the week, because when we get home, I don't know about you guys, but the last thing I want to do is have to make one more decision, right? It's exhausting. Proactivity versus reactivity. Working in the criminal justice field or in law enforcement, a lot of times our job puts us in a role to be reactive to what people do. People bring us crisis, we respond. Crisis, we respond. And so we get in a habit of just waiting for something to happen and responding to it, that's not a healthy habit. So we want to balance that with proactivity at home, in our lives, on the weekends, and in the ways, again, areas that we can control. Third time is time management relationships, investing our time, again, according to our values, in the relationships of things we have control over. Physical fitness, burning off all that extra energy. A lot of times it's up here, isn't it? Not physical energy, let's face it, right? We're tired. It's up here. It's that ongoing da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. It's hard to turn off sometimes. Controlling financial well-being, and then survivors have multiple roles in their lives. And those roles are defined and they're clear. They're groups of women that they meet with, their friendships, their mothers, their daughters, their siblings. And that is all directly tied to resiliency, which is huge when it comes to bouncing back and faster, stronger, and better. You have any questions so far? Everybody knows this. Sometimes we just need a reminder, right? Yeah. So here's death promises. They're corny, but they usually have something nice to say. They encourage you to do something good for yourself, right? I'm gonna pass those
brief, since we want to transition to more question and answer. My name again is Stephanie Guy. I work with South Seattle Community College. I'm a teacher in what we call life service work. Now, part of our curriculum, what we do is we embed a lot of that relationship work, part of that connecting back into the community. So what I'm going to pass around is simply just a quick handout that I we do with our students. However, it's just a quick rebrief on rebuilding those relationships as well. Now, I recommend that passing these around and doing it with a loved one. I know that, for example, I've had a lot of amazing mentors in my life, and going and taking this back with your children and walking through it is a key part of that. And also, in the sense of this next handout, what this basically focuses on is in the sense of those takeaways. What are we doing in the sense of our outside life that can help us with that work, doing that balance act, doing that routine? So it's simply just a quick takeaways, so that way we can get more into those questions and answers for that panel as well. Now, three of these is simply invest our time. Where are we investing that time at? What are those other ones for? Thank you very much, and I think we'll start with questions and answers.
Is there anyone else that has a question you'd like to ask the panel?
Okay.
Could you stand and introduce yourself and tell us where you're from?
My name is Kat Mollins. I'm with Spokane SNAP program, which stands for Spokane Neighborhood Action Partners. I was just employed 4 months ago. And I work with Department of Correction Offenders to provide educational services to our offender population within Spokane in the work releases. And so I also am a volunteer for Department of Corrections. I work on the diversity team, and I work very closely with George Turson from Spokane. So my question is for Ms. Wanda, the diversity population, do you have that broken out, the racial sections, do you have that broken out for county?
No, I did bring that today, but okay.
Because
it's available on the website.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I was kind of interested in, you know, versus the west side, which I worked over here for a year. Diversity is, you know, everywhere you go, there's diversity within the department. But on the west side, or the east side of town, or east side of the state, it's not very prevalent over there. So I was really interested in that statistic.
Yeah, I do have it by appointed authority, so actually, I just have to show it to you.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
One of the field areas. Spokane, they have three African Americans, three Native Americans, one Asian, and eight Hispanics. A total of 15.
And you work with Laura out there, right? Laura Jens?
Mm-hmm.
Jens.
Yes,
Jens.
I do.
She
yes.
can probably help you track that information
yes,
down
this
as well.
This is for all of the area.
Yeah. And I think too, it's also reflective of the state. So the east side of the state is not as diverse as the west side of the state. And so that's also going to be reflected in who's working for DOC as well. If you've got a predominantly white population, which we do on the east side, or the east side of the state, that's kind of what you're going to be seeing as far as employees.
Right. But my what I'm really interested in is because there's individuals that's being released in the community, and they are of diverse backgrounds. And so it makes a big difference if the person that's coming to the east side of the state is able to look to see somebody that looks like them, which could add to the success of that person and the connection of that person to help undergird and mentor that person.
Okay, any other questions? Go ahead. Stan and your name.
Do I give the full introduction? my name is Lane Pavey. I am a mental health clinician. I'm a formerly incarcerated person. I work in the Smart Justice Spokane campaign. I am the CEO of Revive Reentry Services. We are a DOC housing vendor. So I do a lot of stuff over in Spokane, but I wouldn't have done any of this stuff if I had never been incarcerated and learned everything about the system. And one reason I wanted to come to this was to ask you guys about the way women are disempowered in prison, especially when there are male guards. And you guys had spoke a little bit to the ratio and kind of the difference in energy in the blocks when women guards are around men, but men guards around women, this paternalistic daddy energy that comes out and women being treated sort of like junior high kids, being referred to as girls, drama makers, manipulators, and then of course they act the way that they are told they're acting. So I'm just wondering, like, what is the Department of Corrections doing to sort of take responsibility for empowering women in those situations and ensuring that that paternalism is not something that continues to happen if the rotation of male staff that's in there is sort of babysitting? And do you notice that? I'm sure you're aware of this, but what can be done to help empower women when they're in those situations, they're not just being guarded or watched or essentially disempowered? Can you speak to that, I guess?
I think it starts with us educating our staff. And we were forced to redo our education with the PREA laws, and because of the fact that when you look at the number of PREA incidents that we've had in the department, most of them were staff to offenders, not so much offender to offender, but most staff to offender, which then meant that we needed to train our staff and to go back and go through what is it that would cause you to cross that line from being a professional and getting into the wrong type of relationship with an offender. And so it started with the education. It's also started with working with the women, again, with the gender responsive programming that we are initiating and taking on. Two is helping to improve the women offenders and their self-worth and start valuing themselves.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, I think a lot of it is the gender-informed services, you know, trauma-informed. I think that, you know, the instance of women being incarcerated is increasing, and so it's almost forced their hand to some degree. You know, for instance, at the work release, I used to work at Helmby Ratcliffe, which is an all-female work release facility in Seattle. You know, they've done a lot of work toward bringing in, moving on, and they do Thinking for a Change, which is new in work release. They also have a residential parenting program, so women who give birth while at WCCW can transition there with their child and actually reunify with their child in work release. Their other children in work release while having their baby with them. So I mean, I think there's steps that are being made, but with an agency like DOC of that size, and you know, it's a bureaucracy. I mean, change is slow, but there are definitely, you know, if you look at some of the reports that DOC puts out, being gender aware is a priority for them. So that's a step in the right direction.
Yes,
yeah.
Stan, please.
My name is Yesenia Monzo. I'm a criminal justice liaison for staff in Aitkin County. I was wondering, what is the training that exists and protocol for transgender women?
Okay, so are you saying women who are incarcerated or for staff?
Yes.
Okay.
Both.
Okay.
If there's any for staff, but I was mainly thinking for women that are incarcerated.
I can speak to the PREA piece a little bit. I'm not as familiar with what is done necessarily in the prisons. I know what the standards say. And, you know, like, it's kind of like a policy. It's relatively vague. And, but, you know, that you aren't allowed to do a pat search just to identify what gender somebody, biological gender somebody is. But there is a lot of training going on now with regard to understanding pronouns and understanding, you know, but again, I mean, in prison, and especially in some of these states, especially the ones who aren't willing to come to compliance, change is very slow. But transgender, identifying somebody as either homosexual or transgender or intersex, is a part of the risk assessment. So when somebody comes into a new facility, whether it's prison, work release, or anything else, they're identified as a potential victim right away. And so they have to be housed differently than anyone else, but in a confidential manner.
so nobody else knows why it is they're housed differently. So for safety reasons, there's training going on around that.
Thank you. Anyone else? Yeah, I have a couple questions for you. How do we embrace diversity and inclusion within the corrections workforce and peers, administration, programs, inmates, and the community? And it's for each one of you. How do you embrace diversity within your work?
I think understanding, coming from a place where you understand that a diverse workplace is a more productive workplace, and studies time and time again show that. So just understanding that, that's not necessarily going to say that, as a hiring manager, that I'm going to hire someone just because of this attribute, but I think coming from a place of that understanding is the best place to start.
I think it has an aspect of when you're working with a team, that mentorship that you have with your team as well. So creating that positive atmosphere has a lot to do with obviously helping out, right? Being kind to each other in the sense of when you know that, for example, being a brand new faculty member, having other faculty members assist me in the sense of this is how you teach in this scenario or that. It's very beneficial in that sense. And also, not only do I learn from them, but in the sense we learn from each other. So that also creates that diversity because you're expanding out in that sense.
I think it moves me. I know a lot of times we were stuck on doing potlucks. It's beyond moving beyond the potluck or the diversity food. It is an education. It's time for us to sit and talk about the diversity amongst us. It's not. When we talk about diversity, it's not just talking about race. We're talking about diversity. Each one of us is diverse. And so it's understanding in what we have at work, a diversity moment, and anyone can bring in a topic, and we'll discuss it so that we can learn more about the individual of the topic that we're discussing.
Has anyone heard of the Privilege Walk? It's a training or an exercise. There's recently a video online that came out about it. And so essentially, everybody starts in the same place and they start asking questions. So if you don't feel safe when you walk to work every day, take a step back. Or so they ask a bunch of questions that have to do with privilege for any number of reasons, gender, race, gender identity, anything like that. And it's a visual of where everybody ends up in the room. And it's, I think, in this video, if you end up finding the one I found, everybody at the beginning kind of starts, it's, lighthearted and stuff like that. And at the end, it's pretty somber, especially for some of the folks that are way up in front of some of the other people in the room. So I would just, if you're interested in it, I would try to find that video. It's an interesting exercise in the workplace, too.
I think people are interesting. I think it's a whole lot more fun to learn about diversity and expand our world if we start with the premise that people are interesting. If I see something that I don't understand or comprehend, I'm gonna if that person's comfortable, I'm gonna ask. And if I think that person might not feel comfortable, I'm gonna go ask somebody who's got a similar background and say, tell me about this, because I want to get it. Because I'm not gonna get you as a human being if I don't get where you came from and what matters to you and what you value. And I think, yeah, people are just interesting. It's fun.
We've talked a bit about can women do the same things that men do, and in your opinion, is equity truly attainable within corrections for female and male staff?
I think yes, with the exception of the rules with regard, rightfully that exist in terms of sexual safety. I think we can do anything that they do. Yeah.
I think it has to do with trusting your gut, feeling comfortable in that sense. We all know what we're capable of in that sense, and if this is a goal that we want to obtain, that sense of a career field, then that's kind of the pathway that we'll forge.
Yes. Hello. Could you stand and give us your name and what agency
Yes, my name is Jennifer and I'm with Pacific Associates. I'm a career navigator. And my question for the women working in corrections is, how do you find the environment to be? Is it inclusive amongst women? Or like in a lot of fields, you know, even though it's a predominantly male field, it seems like a lot of women will gravitate more towards what men are doing, and then they kind of isolate each other, almost like horizontal violence. But my question is it an inclusive environment where women stick together and empower each other and encourage each other so that, you know, these types of growth can happen, or is it just individualism within that?
I think that's a great question.
Sorry.
Because oftentimes a woman's worst enemy could be another woman.
Yep.
Absolutely. It triggers an insecurity. Instead of saying, wow, I want to become like her, it's a, like, it's, right? Yeah, absolutely. And it's a very dangerous place to be. As a matter of fact, Ms. Guy and I were talking about this, there was some apprehension about being on a panel where women were the entire audience, right? Because probably every woman in here at some point has experienced a lot of negativity from that. I apologize for the token male.
Yes.
And I think so much of it, in my experience, comes from getting to a place where my only job is to be the very best me that I can be. Not the very best Stephanie or Runette, just the very best me that I can be. And then when I see other women doing really cool things that maybe I even wish I had those skills, instead of focusing on that, celebrating them for those things. And that's a hard place to, that's a hard place for a lot of people to get, especially when it triggers a deep insecurity. I think it starts with simple things. When you're going out with friends, dress appropriately so you're not going to trigger a friend's significant other to look at you sexually. Common sense, right? Mm-hmm. Not so in our culture always. And so it just seems like the very basics of respect, encouraging, uplifting. If you know your girlfriend's got a trigger, don't go there. Respect it, love her through it, right? If she's got a strength, cheer her on. Yeah, that's right, that's right. Yeah, words speak life and they speak death, and we get to choose our words.
Okay.
Yeah.
One more question.
Oh no, I was just getting started.
Okay, well, thank you all very much. Let's give our panel a hand for the great job that they've done. And if you're seeking other information, please sign up, and I'm leaving this side up for just a minute. I think there's another group here if you want contacting.